excited. So I went to the opening worship service, and that year the theme speaker, the main presenter was Paul Scott Wilson, who's the United Church person. So there were a lot more United Church people at this event than would normally be at the McMaster Preaching Festival. And it was, the worship was very Baptist, and very much coherent with the Baptist tradition, ethos, and polity. And I went out into the social area after, and the United Church people were all standing a little huddled, going, "I just can't believe that. Did you hear me?" Complaining, and I thought, you know, if I go to a vegetarian's house for supper and I get a nut cutlet, it's not really appropriate to complain. Okay. Even if I don't like nut cutlets. And if you know, one of my sons had a vegan girlfriend, this was very challenging. Right? Having all the recipes scrutinized before the food would be consumed. Anyway, but United Church people are kind of like that. They think that our ethos is the dominant ethos, and everybody should do the things we do them the way we do them. And so at this Baptist event, at the Baptist Divinity College, there was all this pitching and moaning about the language of the hymns and so on. This is bad form. When in Rome. It's important to have connections with people outside. So talk to strangers, and really, the stranger the better. Make friends with the Pentecostal pastor. Get to know her. She'll be a very interesting person. You know, everybody needs a Roman Catholic friend who has particular devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary and loves to do adoration of the Blessed Sacrament with the monstrance. You know, every Protestant needs someone like that in their lives. And so I think it's very important to talk to strangers and cultivate those kinds of connections. Our house is up for sale. And then my next door neighbor is a very devout Roman Catholic. And I was talking to her. It was actually the day I was putting our big nativity set away at home. And Stephanie said to me, "Well, I've been praying to St. Joseph about the sale of your house," and I thought, well, I've, you know, Protestants, we have a direct line, but that's nice, you know, thank you. That's nice. Anyway, somebody else told me that if you really want your house to sell, you take a statue of St. Joseph and you bury it upside down in your yard. So I was putting the nativity set away. I picked up Joseph and I said, "Okay, buddy. You better come through here." Anyways, the house still has been sold. I should have put him in the yard, apparently. Yeah, so first thing, talk to strangers. The second thing is embrace instability. Instability is really good for you. I have a teacher friend who talked about her principal, and she said, "Oh, he's in a rut and he loves it." You never want them to say that about you. She's in a rut and she loves it. Now, nobody likes control more than I do. Nobody loves order and predictability more than I do. But feeling stable and feeling in control and having all your ducks lined up in a row is a very dangerous place to be spiritually. Because when you're absolutely in control, you don't really leave any room for the Holy Spirit to come and shake things up and take you in a different direction. And an example of the danger of stability within the context of ministry that I particularly want to look at is moving. Do you remember moving? You put your books into 70 million boxes, and you give away a bunch of stuff, and you put everything else in a truck, and you move from one location to another. Does anybody remember this concept? Yeah.
All too well.
Good. Glad to hear. Now, I think if you go in your church and you look around, you'll see either a rogues gallery of former pastors all lined up, or there's a list somewhere of the people who used to be the pastor at your church. And if you look at it, I want you to take a minute to do this when you're home and look at how frequently the pastor of your church used to change. Mm-hmm. Right? 2 years, 3 years, 3 years, 2 years, 3 years, five years. That one was 5 years. You look at a United Church yearbook from even as recently as 20 or 30 years ago, and you'll see pastors moving, changing presbyteries, changing, even changing conferences multiple times over the course of a ministry. We are a much less mobile ministry than we used to be. Much, much less. We not only stay within our congregations longer, but the pattern I see now is people move, but they move within their presbytery. They go from within the presbytery, from a call here to an appointment there to a call there. And there are some drawbacks to this. Within a presbytery, for example, things can get a little stale. Nobody is coming in with fresh ideas. Nobody's coming in with a new setup. Well, you know how we did it in such and such a place. Nobody comes with these new bits of wisdom to share. The other problem with moving, everybody moving within the presbytery, nobody coming in and nobody going out, is this, is that nothing ever gets resolved. Right? Old feuds linger on and on and on. These things just simmer on. There's going to be differences. There are theological differences. There are personal differences. There are aspirational differences. We can get in each other's way. And when we all stay, it's like the depths of winter, you know, when you've been in the house together too long. Garrison Keillor says sometimes your wife looks at you and she wonders if you were worth $5 for the license. At the end of a long winter, I used to pastor a church where a man had, one of the men in the church had a sugar bush that belonged to his dad. And it was the old kind with the pails, and he had a sugar shack where they boiled the syrup down. And he said that he was personally responsible for saving several marriages every winter with retired men. Because they would get to the end of the winter, and their wives had just had it with them, but now they could go to the sugar shack and work for, you know, 3 or 4 weeks. And he said he really contributed to marital harmony in the entire township. And in a presbytery, if nobody comes in and nobody goes out, we get a little bit on each other's nerves. Nobody moves away, and so these things simmer on, and they're like a beef stew gone bad. And they fill the whole place up with an unpleasant and unpalatable state. So moving is just one example of the instability that I encourage you to cultivate. It's okay to move. Now I know it's a lot more complicated now because clergy own their own homes. That's made things very different. Used to be you just moved from a manse with your stuff to another manse with your stuff. And I am so venerable that I lived in a furnished manse. Furnished manse, remember that? The furniture in the furnished manse?
I just moved into one 10 months ago.
Wow.
Early attic.
No, the manse furniture is, it's not good enough for my house, it's too good to go to the dumps, so we put it in the manse. That's manse furniture. One glance I lived in, I found the list of what was required to be in the manse, and I think it was from the 1950s. It was typed on a typewriter and with carbon. And on that list of what was required to be in the manse, I was surprised when I saw this. It wasn't just couch and beds and desks and table and chairs and refrigerator and stove. It was also electric kettle, electric iron, lawnmower, snow shovel, even bed linens and table linens. So when the moving happened in those days, you put your books and your grandma's china and the kids' toys and your clothes, and it went in a little vehicle and off you went to the new manse. Now it's way more complicated now, right? You got a house sale and a house purchase to consider, and minister spouses often make considerably more money than the minister does, right? So if your spouse has to replace a job and your spouse earns 40% more than you do, that is a real disincentive to moving. Also, another thing that's made it different, it now seems to me that having that required children to change schools is viewed, at least in some quarters, as tantamount to child abuse. I'm not sure how that happened. So I encourage you, whether it's moving or in some other way, to bring some instability into your life. It is possible to move. We moved from Eastern Ontario to Southwestern Ontario, a 7-hour drive, with an 8-year-old, an almost 4-year-old, an almost 2-year-old, and a 3-week-old baby. And we lived to tell the tale. These things can be done. Having everything set up and having everything organized and having everything all laid out makes it extremely difficult for the Holy Spirit to wedge in and to stir things up and to lead us into new possibilities. So, talk to strangers and destabilize your life. Number three. Here's another little bit of unconventional wisdom. If it's not your job, do it anyway. You are absolutely right about this. It is not your job to help with the spaghetti supper. It is not your job to wash dishes after coffee hour. It is not your job to take more than your fair share of doing the nursing home services. It is not your job to deal with the mice and the mans, or the snow on church walkways, or that impossible woman on the board of trustees. None of those are your job, but think about doing it anyway. And I have several reasons for this. If it's not your job, think about doing it anyway. Number one, do things with an ulterior motive. So I don't know about city churches, as I said, but in country churches, there are people who think they belong to your church. They're not on any list. You don't ever see them in worship. They don't give any money. But they come and help at the big annual event, the fundraisers particularly. And they will serve at the roast beef dinner. They will haul and out and set up tables for a yard sale. And they will bring in 2 annual lemon pies. If you are around when they show up, this is your perfect opportunity to make conversation and to get to know them and to wedge open the tiniest little bit of an opening that may eventually give you a crack into a relationship. And if you're not there to set tables, then you won't be there for your real job. And your real job is to reach out into your community with the love of God in Christ Jesus. And we know that that almost always starts with desultory conversation about the weather and the price of gasoline. But if you're not there, you won't be in conversation. If it's not your job, try doing it anyway and bring into play your ulterior motive for being there. Adrian mentioned that we're in the midst of a big building project. We're tripling the seating in our sanctuary. And the construction company we're working with is a fairly new company. We have a long experience design build company that we started with, and the owner of that's about my age, and he decided to turn the building part over to this other new company. They're all very young. They're all men in their early 20s. So the guy we have working with us, our project manager, is Josh. And it's a pretty big project, you know, it's $750,000, and it's his first real job. And he organizes the trades, he does what needs to be done, and he is efficient, and he's capable, and he keeps his cool. He's very eager to please, and he's a PK. So he gets it about churches. He understands that there are 217 bosses on this job, all of whom have an opinion about how long it's taking and what should be done next. And he's doing a great job. And the other thing he has done, God bless him down on the ground, we have been in church for worship every Sunday. We have not had to leave our building. Now, sometimes we were worshiping in a space not entirely secured from the elements, but, and it's been interesting. But he's moved heaven and earth to make that happen and had a couple of knockdown dragouts with the trades to make sure that could happen. He's done a great job. But you know what people say about Josh? On 3 successive Thursdays, when Bible study was about to begin, we had a horrendous winter in our area this year. On 3 successive Thursdays, he came and shoveled the walkway from the parking lot to the church house because the guys hadn't got there to do it yet.
It's not his job, but you look at the goodwill that has bought him. It makes people kindly disposed to him. And when he says, no, I can't do that, people are much more accepting of that because he has done something that clearly is not his job. Now, I don't know if Josh has an ulterior motive, or he might just be the really nice Dutch CRC boy that he appears to be. But I'll tell you this, if he's doing the snow shoveling with an ulterior motive, it is working. It's really working. The second reason why you should do things that aren't your job, first is, you know, get your ulterior motives in there. The second reason that you should do it is that it will build up credit for you. I've been supervising ministry interns since 1984, before a lot of you were born. And one of the things I asked interns as we worked together to envision is a transparent bank. A transparent bank. And it's their credibility bank. And you've got to build up in the credibility bank. Every time you do something that is not your job, it's like putting coins in that bank. Now, we also build up coins in the bank when we do things that are our responsibility. When we teach well-prepared confirmation classes, when we do good new member orientations, when we get to the hospital to make the visit. I wanted to go to the hospital on Friday, and it didn't work out because I'd forgotten about something at 12:30, and something at 2, and something at 4:45. And on Saturday, I went into the city, half an hour away, to the florist with my daughter to order the flowers for her wedding. And I really wanted to go home. I did not want to get in the car and drive from St. Catharines to Hamilton and then loop back around home and add about 3 hours to my Saturday. I didn't want to do it. I really didn't want to do it. But I did it anyway. And it was a really important visit to make. When I got to church on Sunday, the co-chair of my building committee, whose sister it was I went to visit, said, "How's Dorothy?" If you say, "I don't know, I didn't get there," or "I know," it builds up credibility when you do your job. It really does. Going to 50th wedding anniversaries and nursing home and funeral home visitations. And when you pray with the dying, all of these are seen, and they are noted, and they are discussed in your congregation. And they all build up in the pastor's bank goodwill. So that when the inevitable comes, and there is a screw-up, major or minor, there's some capital in there to draw on. When you refer to the deceased by the wrong name at a funeral, I learned my lesson though. A lot of people go by their middle name, right? And I didn't ask, but I learned. In my defense, I was 22 years old. But anyway, I did that. When you get lost driving to a wedding and arrive at the exact moment that the wedding is supposed to start, I did that too. Or when you go out in the driveway to get the car to drive to the meet with the widow about the funeral and discover that you have given all the cars away to other drivers in the family, you did that too. When you screw up, when you say what you shouldn't say, when you lose your temper, when you accidentally betray a confidence because you assume the other person knew, when you screw up, there will be something in the bank to draw on. And you can fill it up with doing the things you're supposed to do, but when you do the things that aren't your job, sometimes they don't take a lot of time and effort, but they're there when you need to draw on them. You build up credit by doing things that aren't your job. And the third reason for doing things that aren't your job is that you get to offer it up to the Lord. Catholics say that about trials, just offer it up to the Lord. And I know it all sounds a little Holy Mary, But I think it's very, very evocative, this language, offering it out to the Lord. You do it for Jesus. You take on a little burden for his sake. You love people in his name. So you take on a little extra burden and you offer it up to the Lord. This is especially the case when nobody knows that it was you that tidied up and put away everything after the event. You just offer it up to the Lord. You do it when nobody knows that you bought the supplies and paid for the stuff without turning in a receipt. You just offer it up to the Lord. Nobody sees, nobody thanks you, but your Heavenly Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And not to lay it on too thickly, Christ went to the cross. I can go to the nursing home volunteer appreciation team. And more than once. Christ went to the cross, and you can go to the Presbytery Camp Trivia Night fundraiser even when you'd rather be in front of a hockey game at home. Now, I am well aware that what I am saying comes into conflict with what is a sacred cow in the United Church. The untouchable and unassailable doctrine of fairly recent origin, and that is the sacred duty of self-care. And I'd like to note on my permanent record that I am not saying that you shouldn't take care of yourself. You absolutely have to take care of yourself. It's like that little movie they show you in the airplane to scare the bejabbers out of you just before takeoff. You know, they show the movie and they say, if in the event of an unanticipated change in cabin pressure, a mask will drop down in front of you. Put the mask on the person, put your own mask on first before assisting the person you're traveling with. And it shows this really calm looking woman putting her mask on and then putting the mask on her child beside her. But it does make perfect sense. Because only when you have your own mask on are you still continuing to breathe, right? And to function well enough to be able to help the person beside you. You get your own mask on first and breathe deeply, and then you can help. And that's why you have to take care of yourself. You take care of yourself because if you don't, you get overextended and you get stressed and the cracks start to show fairly quickly. In my own case, those cracks are called grumpiness, ill temper, retreat, and poor concentration. In other people, it's depression or severe anxiety, and boy, can anxiety be severe. So get your mask on. Take care of yourself. Have time for friends and family and fun and whatever it is that nourishes you. Whether that's riding your bike or watching the Jays or tinkering with cars or quilting or ballet class, whatever it is that makes you feel full of joy and full of life. You have to have time and space to pray and to think and let your mind wander off down alleyways and around dead ends and back out again, and sometimes even to the solution. And you remember when you were a kid, you used to lay back and watch the clouds? Remember how long the summer was when you were 8 years old? Right? You need a little of that in your life. And it varies from individual to individual what that consists of. But you need time and space to dream, to think, to consider, and to get lost a little bit. And to pray. So you have to have time to do all these things. But, even in the busiest of church seasons and in the most demanding of churches, it is very often the case that there is time and space to take care of ourselves and do what needs to be done and be what needs to be need, and even to do things that aren't really our job. Sometimes it's a matter of organization. Sometimes it's a matter of delegation. And sometimes it is a case of taming time wasters. Everyone here wastes time on things that don't really fulfill them and don't really enrich their lives. They just suck up time and energy and attention with no payback. It might be Facebooking. It might be chatting.
Not the Cruxifusion group.
It might be checking ball scores repeatedly. He's not here. Or checking email repeatedly. Sometimes there's an activity that is restorative for this person, but in that person it's a time waster, right? Just a chewer up of time and energy. There's a young mom in my congregation with two small kids. She has a demanding job. She works in the insurance industry. She's an adjuster. And 2 years ago, she was commuting from where we live to Mississauga, which with traffic is at least 2 hours.
One way.
She was offered the opportunity to telecommute. And she grabbed it with both hands. And she gained hours a day in commuting time. But she also told me this, which I found fascinating. She said, until she worked from home, she had no idea how much time at work was being taken up by visiting, stopping by somebody's desk for a chat. She had no idea how much unproductive time was being used in her workday. As a matter of fact, she estimates that it's 60 to 90 minutes a day. That's a lot of time. That's a lot of time. And you add that to the commuting. Her kids go out the door at 10 to 8, and they arrive back home at 10 after 3, and she works a full workday and is able to do, she volunteers for a lot of stuff at the church and everything. But she 90 minutes a day, that's a lot of time. And she didn't know where it was going. And I know myself that when I get myself sorted and when I concentrate and pay attention, I can create whole swaths of time. I do it. I know it can be done. So that I have time to get done what I need to get done. And sometimes I even have time to do things that aren't my job at all. To just do it anyway. So, talk to strangers, embrace the instability, do it even if it isn't your job. And here's another, this is the fourth of the five. Love the unlovable. Love the unlovable. Jesus was very, very good at this. He loved lepers, and he loved fallen women, and he even loved those impossibly thick as two planks disciples. You think you've got recalcitrant board members, impossible trustees, and incompetent committee chairs. You just look at the disciples. Jesus had the disciples, and he loved them. He loved them. And if you can love your congregation, and they really know it, and they really believe it, they'll trust you, and they'll let you try almost anything, including the most harebrained of schemes. How will they know that you love them? Well, the same way that your spouse knows. By your words and by your actions. They'll know. Show up. Show up. Be prepared. Speak to your congregation and of them with positive regard. Firmly resist the temptation to complain about them all the time. People tend to live up to the expectations we have of them. And if you love them and they know it, and you kind of show it in the way you act and what you say and what you talk about with them, it's amazing what a difference it makes. Celebrate every tiny thing that anybody does that is remotely helpful. Thank people. Pray for them.
And tell them you're praying for them. And I think email, you know, it's the devil's tool in a lot of ways, but it's the most helpful invention because it's so simple, it's so fast, and you don't disturb anybody. The little email that says, so happy to hear of the arrival of your new grandchild. I'm praying Thanksgiving for you. I heard about your medical test. You were in my prayers. Do your best at the hockey tournament this weekend and be a Christian athlete. Somebody recently sent me a photograph she took of the bulletin board in her son's university residence room, and tacked up was a printout of a two-sentence email I sent with my prayer and best wishes during exam week. This kind of stuff takes really like 10 minutes a week, maybe? And as we show our love and concern for the people under our care as pastors, it develops in us a pattern of caring and nurturing so that when they're driving us straight up the flaming wall, we can remember how much we love them. And it means that with even the most unlovable people, we can find some shreds, some traces of care and a positive regard for them. Now, I do have a caveat here. This does not mean you let people behave in bad ways. All right? Sometimes you have someone in your church who is unlovable because she is destructive or because he is dangerous. They don't respect others. They have their needs met by stirring up trouble and creating dissension, right? People who like division and argument. You love people like that, but it is your pastoral responsibility to protect your flock from them. As every parent knows, loving your children sometimes means saying no firmly and repeatedly. We do not let 7-year-olds drive cars. We do not let 11-year-olds get married. And the pastor doesn't turn a blind eye to bad behavior. You cannot turn a blind eye to the bored retiree who is busy building up an empire at your men's Bible study group, who brooks no disagreement with his pronouncements, who spreads rumors about what's really going on at the council meeting. You cannot turn a blind eye to it. That's not loving that person. It's giving license to bad behavior. And something I find very difficult to do is to remember that if I say yes to you behaving badly, I am saying to the 26 people influenced by you, no, we are not going to take care of you. Because when you say yes to this, you're saying no to that. But when you say no to bad behavior, you're saying yes to people who want to get to know Jesus, want to learn how to be a more effective disciple, want to share their gifts in the community. Now, I think that standing up to bad behavior is probably the most difficult and challenging aspect of a pastor's calling. Lovingly meeting out discipline, it's very difficult. Your church is set up to help you avoid that responsibility. And our culture firmly denies that you have any right to take such matters in hand. But as many of you know or will know, ignoring these problems and hoping that they will just go away is about as effective as shoveling snow off your sidewalk with a teaspoon. Tough love is very tough on the pastor. It's very tough. And sometimes you have to have an awful lot of capital built up in your credibility bank, your credibility account, in order to the authority to take on addressing bad behavior. Now, one huge advantage when facing these kinds of issues, these difficult issues, is to have a full team of help. And the team, well, that's, of course, the leaders in your congregation, plus any support you're blessed enough to be able to muster at home. And I know not everybody has that. Another part of your team are the colleagues you have nurtured over time so that you have somebody to kick ideas around with. But if you don't build relationships with people, there's nobody to call when disaster strikes. Another part of your team are mentors or coaches you consult. I use continuing education money. I try to be creative with it. I paid Amadeus to teach me how to do things on the computer, which I thought was... I mean, how many useless continuing education events have you been to? This, at least, I learned something. It was one-on-one, so I actually learned how to do it, and I still know how to do all things, which I thought was pretty effective. But I also engaged in another point in a series of coaching sessions with a coach pastor, and I found that really, really helpful, just to have that one-on-one, and he asked me extremely hard and challenging and annoying questions was really effective. Another part of your team is someone outside your denominational circle who is unfamiliar enough with how things work in your denomination that they might actually ask you a basic enough question that the resolution comes into sight. Because you know you get too close, right? You just get right up close to somebody from the outside who doesn't understand our particular pathologies in the United Church can ask really helpful questions, right? Because they're coming from the outside, and that's good. Another part of your team, you know, God bless you if you've got one like we have in Hamilton Conference, your conference personnel officer. Ours is fabulous. And another key part of your team in facing difficult issues is having your own developed, consistent, and always growing prayer life. It is astonishing the number of pastors who try to do this without a prayer life. And it's like an airplane without wings. That last one is the most important of them all. It's the only way to love your congregation. Is through prayer, particularly the unlovable in your congregation. And I got one last bit of unconventional wisdom. After you talk to strangers and embrace instability and do what isn't your job and love the unlovable, the last thing I want to encourage you to do is to drink beer. Now, if you know me at all, this is really unconventional because I don't drink beer. And I don't drink wine, and the only kind of alcohol I like are those embarrassing ones with the little umbrella and the fuse fruit skewers, right? And if I have more than one of those, if I were to ever have more than one of those, I'd be more embarrassing than the tequila sunrise itself. So when I say drink beer, I mean metaphorical beer. The beer that you drink with a few fellow pastors. Have a beer. Blow up some steam, loan each other books, try out some ideas, do some therapeutic moaning about the presbytery executive or the annual statistical reports or the comprehensive review. Because teachers have a staff room, and factory workers have a lunchroom, and business types have networking sessions, but pastors very often work way too much in isolation. Nobody knows to trouble I see. Right? I think the internet has really helped with this, with Facebook and the posts that keep people connected and with Skype, it's amazing. And the Cruxifusion group posts, they're a godsend, but whatever form it takes, online or in the flesh, we all need to talk with other people who get it. So have a beer. Bill made reference to the group at Niagara that gets together every other Friday for a beer at a sports bar. The attendance is very irregular. The size of the group goes, you know, from 2 to 16 on a major occasion, depending on other commitments. And sometimes I haven't been for almost 2 months. It just hasn't worked out. Friday's when we get the church ready for Sunday now, and we meet at 4 o'clock and figure out. Every Friday at 4 o'clock, we find out which parts of the building we'll have this weekend. So I think it's kind of important to be there. So I haven't been, but I know... Even though I haven't been there, that group is still meeting, and I know it's there, and I know that I'm connected to those people, and that they get it, right? They get it. We all need people who get it. So, drink beer, love the unlovable, even if it's not technically your job, do it, embrace instability, talk to strangers, and have fun! They used to say about it in the Army, but it's really true in ministry, there really is no life like it.
There's no life like it. And as Paul wrote to Timothy, "For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline." Amen?
Amen. Amen.